Now, those of you who are in philosophy sync will probably remember that I made my demo then out of dirt related to whiskey selling now. And I actually brought a real bottle of whiskey to back it up, which I think some of you have fond memories. Anyway, this year's demonstration is not about a whiskey selling app. However, never let me say that slots are mean. So I have in fact brought a bottle of Clanross single malt, rare. You can see it's rare, there's not much of it. bring you. And foolishly, I told this to Andreas, and he said, well, in that case, he will bring a bottle of German whiskey. So he did. He brought a bottle of Elbe. I didn't even know it was German whiskey, but he brought a bottle of Elbe. So, okay. So I thought, well, if he's going to be like that, I thought if he was going to be so generous as to bring that, then I would obviously have to bring another bottle of that.
And it had a rare, but
2 protocol for Postgres is so old it's actually seriously deprecated by Postgres and it's not going to be supported quite soon. So we now have a proper Postgres 3 in the X series. You can connect your sockets in a good old-fashioned way, or we've also implemented their C API, so if you want, you can connect your way you do to Oracle and various other things we would see and get the API you want there. If you load your old connection class, PostgreSQL gets the other connection. Then that will simply, by default, give you the new connector. However, the old one still works. It's available from our website. You can download and install it. It will then take precedence. So we move over at your own time. We, of course, encourage you to move over promptly and rename your own calls. Now, the old goodie never bound. Our new goodies do indeed bind. C connection will take bound values. The socket will also take bound values, although by default it will not, because until and unless we improve the skill of it, it will actually run rather faster if you just let it write the values into the SQL string. But we see some value for that long term. So you just might want to be aware of that if you were calling, imagining you were binding values over sockets. The old one basically you didn't mean that, and so it carefully ignored you. The new one will not ignore you, but you might wish it to. And that's a point you can talk to us about if you want, but I'll need to bring that discussion to the whiskey tasting. A more interesting subject is perhaps array binding. The C API in principle can do array binding. But although Postgres is free, array binding on Postgres' C API is not free. You have to pay money to Enterprise DB to get that feature. So we have not implemented it, but obviously if there are customers who actually pay for their Postgres, please tell us and that's that great information if you can do so. So, on to the thing we're proudest of, which is it survives inspection. And I do mean that quite literally. You can open an inspection on the new Postgres. The rare old bug was quite simply that if you formed sessions on the same connection, you could get some really surprising results. I mean, picking up your phone and getting a shower results. You could ask for a while, you could get something utterly different. And this was basically because when you executed your SQL calls, everything was dumped on the socket. Order of execution, but of course you were not guaranteed to read it that way. One of the shortcuts on the facade was when we're unthreaded, it would always just dump everything. It would ignore the request, give me the next one, then the next one, then the next one out of the cursor, which of course was potentially non-performant, but at least it meant that unthreaded you could never get ask for one thing and get something different. But if you were threaded, and if you were opening the inspector in the debugger, it was very natural to be threaded, quite easily be in that situation, and you do get that something utterly weird, which didn't exactly help the developers. Anyway, the new one is fine. The C API one unthreaded is actually fine by default. The issue comes back if you have a threaded C API, but again, we're expecting people to find the sockets and the C unthreaded API a good combination for times when you want. When you want the C, or you simply want the socket to be ready to background or freeze up your image. So we're only releasing a threaded C API in preview and probably will move from there unless customers actually say, hey, no, we have something to be using. But for the C API, I'm afraid we have no problem. For the sockets API, I described the solution on the slide. You can read it if you're interested. The short version is it works. The long version is we do some thread safe buffering such that you only do it when you have to do it. The problem, which was certainly involved a little thinking. So much for our ability to actually connect to the databases. Now, Glorp, thank you very much, Esteban. You've given a great idea for Glorp. I will have a reminder for anyone who needs it, just what Glorp is. Glorp, you can see what it stands for in the list there. It's letting you address relational database models as if they were made possible for objects. It's job to hide the fact that you've got object-oriented systems and relational database systems which are very different ideas of how to model the world. As you can see in the trivial example, it's basically aiming to let you write very small talk-like statements based on your models. It already allows you to look a lot like small talk, and our goal is basically to expand form to its natural boundaries. Our goal is to get rid of any areas where the user would say, hang on a sec, let me verify this small talk. Why is it working here? And I will talk a little later about the progress we've made towards that problem. Glorp's brainchild about Knight, who previously worked on TopLink, and it was basically him doing everything that he realized TopLink was doing wrong. So in the old making problem, you're running it fast, Glorp is making it right. And it has no passive reference to our restrictions. That's one of the key points. It's not one of those frameworks that runs very fast for its short compare and it helps you out in a wild or another country. It actually aims to talk throughout the lifecycle. Huge, you're starting on a legacy system. You don't have to, obviously, it's fast in greenfields, but it's prepared for that. And it's designed to map efficiently to the external database interfaces. Again, thank you, Mr. Manning, for presenting some context for that. Glorp takes advantage of group writing if your database will support group writing of statements. Glorp takes advantage of binding of data in your statements if your database supports binding of data. Both ways of taking a large number of statements. One more round trip the database, because that's where the performance came. And basically, it's ready to do that when they're available to take advantage of the real world. And finally, of course, Glorp maps Smalltalk to the database, but it also maps the database to Smalltalk. So when you order a transaction, it's not just the transaction in the database that rolls back, the objects you would have written roll back to their starting transaction state in your image. So it keeps the two the same. Okay, so this is what Glorp looks like in the image. A very brief reminder of how it works. I apologize for those who have seen that diagram before. In a while, I will be going up the right side of the diagram and basically generating from the database towards somewhere where Jerry can take over the domain. The idea is, in order to do this mapping, it has to model the database. It has to model the domain, and it has to do the third and largest task of mapping between two. Just for the moment, however, I will be talking over on the left side. The database accessor relates to the stuff Esteban was talking about. You need an accessor for your dialect. That's the key class that says, OK, I'm running VisualWorks, I'm running Farrow, I'm going to actually map. And of course, if as the situation Esteban was talking about, there were various drivers within that API, so you might want to database accessor. In VisualWorks, of course, we have an external database interface layer which has a common API and everything conforms to it. So we simply have one database accessor to map the API. And the unit of work is the pattern that enables you to roll out the image and keep it sync. But another area of interest is the actual database platform. So, two things are going on. There's the EXDI framework, whatever external database interface connections that your image has, and that's handling work. That's handling the job of actually converting some kind of something that your image understands to something that the database server oversees. And typically that's handled by something class hierarchies who have a subclass paired database either protocol, possibly for a version. Our PBC3 at the moment is a separate subclass of PBC standard, and the two may swap around later on. Maybe we'll bring out PBC3 by default and PBC2 class, whether it's not. The Glorp framework has a database platform. which it will or won't tolerate, and you have to respect that. So you have to write your SQL in a dialect that the database will understand, and then you have to have some means of sending it. And up to now, by the education of the cheating, we've been able to pretend, at least in our visual work, that we work at the XBI, that these are essentially one-to-one or those one-to-n. The situation is now progressing. You are tending to get into many, many relationships between these two. You could hope still to work the math, you know, figure out from this string that I'm actually trying to connect to a BDC to a Postgres database. But you do occasionally get into some issues of latency or some opening instructions inside, trying to connect to this database and ask it who it is so you can figure out how to ask it things. So we're looking at various things, including different API. So, for example, for ourselves in our main core using application, stores are our principal one that drives us, but also for our customers, SQL, because you meet this too. The question is, therefore, you may be connecting by something where the connection class easily determines the wire protocol, or you may be connecting. Okay, so much for background issues. So with Glorp, let's start looking at the tool. Before we look at the tool, I just wanted to talk about the fact that Glorp does actually have a do everything it can for you attitude, and it's sometimes worth knowing about this. It will deduce all it can. So here I've got an example of a very simple system. Let's have drivers, let's have vehicles, so two tables in the database, let's have some sort of relation link table that tells you which drivers are driving which vehicles. Here's an example of kind of everything you can tell Glorp about that. You know, your class model for driver knows that it connects to vehicles, your descriptor for driver knows it has many, many mapping vehicles, and you spell out that it uses a link table, what the join is, what the reverse join is, what the link codes are, and so on. And it's just sometimes worth knowing that you don't have to generate all that. One of the uses of the tool I'll demonstrate might be simply to learn Glorp to attach it to a few fragments, generate some Glorp, and look and say, oh, well, that's what Glorp thinks. But often you can say a little less. So for example, in the system that I'm demonstrating, there is no other bridge between driver and vehicle. So you can simply say to the class model for driver, you have an attribute vehicles and it connects to the class vehicle. And Glorp will deduce everything from that. You don't have to write any of the stuff, which is pretty great. You can skip it. Alternatively, you can not even tell the class model you have an attribute vehicle. You can simply say to the descriptor that's doing the mapping, look, I'm telling you there's many to many mapping, far in, he's going to pay all the vehicles plus, which Glorp already knows how to make the table. And at that point, Glorp will deduce everything in a unique situation. Now, maybe it's not quite that simple. Maybe you have a driver has a main vehicle, direct link, as well as sort of more than one main vehicle, as well as other vehicles he could drive. So you might want to tell it, okay, look, I'm telling you this relationship is the one that needs a link table, go find it. Alternatively, you spell it out with Glorp. Telling you, you know, this is, I'm pointing you in the right direction here. Head off that way and you'll find your image. Go find it. Or you can conceivably say, okay, I'm pointing you in the right direction and I'm giving you the first way station. You know, here's the field onward from the link table. Or alternatively, you can say, look, I'm spelling it out for you. Go here, go here, go here. And all of these, it's very much a horses to horses attitude. What exactly you have to do about that. The advantage of a minimalist approach, quite apart from the fact that it's safe and tidy, is that it makes it more robust for some kind of changes. All these tables could change their names, their fields could change, Glorp could still find it. You control the deployment mode without using it. Alternatively, of course, however, if you're not expecting the schema to evolve in that way, if you are expecting someone to add a lot more links between the driver and vehicle, then this was completely unambiguous. Will come out and use the blocking start demand on things. You can wait until it does, but alternatively, you can put this information in. So it's a question of what kind of robustness you're looking at. Do I want to change the names of my fields? Do I want to add new connections? Or do I just want to write a whole ad hoc and in that way when I give it to someone to work on, they'll know exactly what's going on. So it's just a little thought about what's happening there. Again, a little on what we've been trying to do to expand the world to its natural length. So for example, it used to be very annoying, you would have sort of a query where you would be saying, alright, I want to find users that have particular qualities as well as what I specialize in the main thing or if you don't not in it. So you would be doing equals and not equals and in subqueries defined within your main block. And for simple private keys, that's fine. For composite private keys, if somebody's saying in the in case, it would raise a warning. I can't do this with a private key. And in the equals or not equals case, it wouldn't even raise a warning if you're passing SQL to the database. The database would very happy to say this SQL does nothing. Okay, now it works. And it doesn't just work. It actually works efficiently by databases that support composite primary key mapping. This will generate efficient SQL that will get that done fast. And for databases that don't, this query will return in a whole banded composite, which will also get the thing done. Works. So now you don't have to care what the Glorp mapping is, and that's the point. Who cares what the Glorp mapping is? I know my multi-threaded model, I just want to write queries on my multi-threaded model. Ditto for being efficient, and of course that's sort of performing awful this kind of thing. You could do small talk, but with 10 round trips and difference. The whole point is to write complicated SQL that sends one round trip and you just define one model. And same thing is happening here, you can also fetch across a many relationship. In the old days, suppose I say I want to read some customers. No, I just want to read one customer. I just want to read 10. I want to limit the number of customers I read. I don't want all the customers' things. Please fetch their accounts. Just do it all in one round trip. I don't want to get the customers and then go back and get their accounts. So in the old days, it would look at the limited query and it would actually say, oh, you want one customer. So here's one customer and here's one account. Maybe the customer had 10 accounts, but here's one account. And to add insult to injury, you would even respect the order of mapping. Maybe you said, well, customer accounts in order, give me the most valuable accounts. You get that from customer, you get that account in 50p, not because it was the most valuable one, but because it chose the rank. It ignored the order. It now behaves itself in this respect. It will fetch all the accounts of the one customer, and it will fetch them in order. It is okay to nest iterators. My example here is reminding me of those sentences that I was taught at school never to say, please get the user whose orders, whose line items, whose bonuses, whose credits are greater than 50. That's not how you speak English. But it can be very legitimate to write queries with iterators like that, all satisfying, etc., etc. And it can be very legitimate if you're mapping a complicated class hierarchy to a single table, it can be very legitimate to write queries like that. And it was just annoying that sometimes this thing would run out of memory and force you to make two round trips with the database, when in fact you knew perfectly well that making one round trip would be much more efficient because the final number of rows fetched back is much smaller. So again, we've sorted these things out. And there's a lot more. We've done stuff that is quite complicated. Dictionaries, for example, now behave much more robustly and regularly than before. We've done simple things, for example, Joachim, thank you very much for suggesting implementation of rollback for utility. We'll expand there. And not only that, but rollback literals behave somewhat better. Doubles have indexed instars. Who knew? Does anyone here in the habit of going into a double and altering its internal structure? Are there any suspects? Wondrous, you ever done that? I had you as the primary suspect for doing something really weird like that. Anyway, I had no idea about that, but you could actually get straight. strange complaints in Glorp, which was you would have a literal double, and it would say, oh, you know, the user could have changed the internals of this, I've got a check patch, but it's literal, so it objects to having some internal checks, so, before, so. A whole series of other fixes, and I think which are all, but even at the rate I speak, and I will try to speak slower, because I should always need to always speak slower, even at my rate, perhaps, we won't cover all of that, do feel free to ask when you come to the whiskey stand. And of course, there is more to do. We are not completely there, but I think we're really getting more to this natural effort. Okay, the tool. If you've been in past E6, you've seen Glorp or the full process. The full mapping process is an Object Studio suite of tools that allow you to do deep modeling, including deep complex mapping tools. So why would we bother having a simple tool in VisualWorks? Well, first of all, of course, you might not be running on Windows, or you might be in a client and just need to set it all up very fast, show example, or I think probably relevant to this audience, you might just want to look at a schema fragment, generate some Glorp, and use that as a training experience. There might be a number of reasons why you want to do something very quick. So this is not in any way a replacement for the Object Studio tools, it's simply a very quick, tackable way of getting a first cut on. And now, demonstrating what this is going to be talking about, how that might work. So, if I open the Glorp map as you are, here I have a tool which I can connect to my very trivial drivers database. If I connect to it, it will show me the tables, not very many, that are in here. I can actually see it's found the table SQLite position sequencing, which I probably don't want to try doing at this, unless it's blue, let's leave that. And I touched it. I touched it. Come back. This short port is quite irritating. Right. We're back in business. Right. Put this hand behind my back. You're in this hand. Okay, so maybe I say I don't want to see field tables like that. And I can tell it to generate the main class for everything, but I probably don't want to tell it to generate the main class for this, which I can recognize as a link table. I could simply unselect that, and that would tell or maybe it's a link table, that's right. Or I could be more aggressive and simply say, I am going to select it, but I'm going to give it your name. So that is giving more very strong hint. Either way, I just carry on, and now I need somebody to put the classes I'm going to generate. I'll just put them in the trivial package, and I need somewhere to put them. I'll just dump them in the test namespace. I have to choose my preferred superclass. I'll just stick with the system object, or just have to go out to record. Likewise, I don't have to just have a subclass of the scripture system, I can have a subclass of some much more specific thing that was used in my database. And having got so far, I can generate it. And I now have a system. The in some ways more trivial use of this is to actually connect.